Everybody
say amen.
God
has spoken.
So let the church,
say amen.
Yeah. Can I get a
witness? Let the church,
oh,
say amen.
To what his plans are.
Let the church,
to what his word says.
Amen.
God has spoken.
God has spoken.
Let the church,
good evening. Welcome to Wednesday evening service. Those who are out on Zoom and YouTube, let us pray. Father God, hide me behind thee, and let the words of my mouth be yours and not mine.
I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me.
My biblical text is from Acts 27:20. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and when no small tempest lay on us, All hope that we should be saved was then taken away. Let us have our evening prayer. Oh, Father God, we thank you. We thank you for all of those who are listening. Father God, I ask you that you hide me again behind you, that the words of my mouth be of yours and not mine. May the words of your mouth inspire others to be more like you. Hopefully, to bring more souls to you. Thank you.
Amen.
My sermon tonight is titled, When You Can't, God Will. It's tough for us to grasp the idea that God is always with us, that God checks in and never checks out. We don't live that way. We have a time when we go to work and a time when we go home. There is a time to be awake and a time for sleep. We have time for meals and a time for play. We even have times for church. Our lives are scheduled, and we check in and out according to our planned timetable. God does not operate that way. He is omnipresent or ever-present. When we invite him into our hearts, he stays. We may not always sense his presence because we become distracted by the busyness of life, but he is there just the same. Our way of life makes us think that God is someone we need to cram into our already busy schedules. We think we have to make time for him the way we make time for work, play, and life in general. We set aside time to check in with God. Bible study, prayer meeting, church service, and maybe even private devotions at home. But we schedule God the way we schedule everything else. The idea of God's perpetual presence moved missionary Frank Laubach to be in continuous communication with God back in 1884. He kept a journal of his experiment and eventually found it intoxicating to be one with the Lord all the time. But is it realistic? Can we learn to trust that God is present in every situation? The Apostle Paul did. In fact, it's hard to imagine that Paul went through a single day without a close encounter with the Lord. As we look at the background text for our focus scripture, we will discover what it takes to have that closeness with our Heavenly Father. First, it's a matter of relationship. The Apostle Paul was one of several persons on a ship headed to sea under the control of Julius, a centurion, for Caesar Augustus. Paul had a fairly good relationship with Julius, despite his status as a prisoner. And that relationship would prove itself in the face of danger. Paul warned Julius of impending storms, but the ship's captain cast off anyway. Then when the ship encountered a mega storm called Euclidon. It was time to put Paul's relationships to test. He told Julius that despite the severe storm, no one would die in the face of such danger. When the Bible says that we all should save was then taken away, all that we hope we should save was then taken away. How could Paul be so certain? It was not his relationship with Julius that gave him confidence. It was his relationship with Christ. While the ship's passengers feared for their lives, Paul was trusting in the message he had received from an angel of God. The angel said the ship would be lost, but all the passengers would be saved. So even when the ship ran aground and some men tried to launch a small craft to make it to the shore, Paul warned them to stay on board and trust his relationship with the master. When you have an imperious relationship with Christ, you can see what God sees, and you mirror the master. Jesus taught, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise." That's relationship. It's a bending of souls. It is a marriage of the mind, body, and spirit. You look like Jesus. You talk like Jesus. You walk like Jesus. And you act like Jesus. Because you have a relationship with Jesus. It's also a matter of submission. The centurion could have ignored Paul's warning, but Julius saw something in Paul. He saw a man who had given his entire life over to the Lord. A commitment like that is hard to ignore, especially when all of your own decisions have led you astray. So Julius gave Paul full authority to command the ship's passengers. They all decided to ride out the storm with Paul's guard. The challenges of life are nothing but a test to see if you are committed to Christ. You can do all things through Christ, who gives you strength. You can weather any storm and survive any battle as long as you submit to God's plan for your victory. Jesus said, "I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me." Submission is the key. When you wholly and completely submit to God's will, you won't go left when God says go right. You won't quit when God says persevere. You won't speak when God says bite your tongue. You won't do things your way when God says do it my way. Next, it's a matter of trust. When the ship began to take on water and break apart, Paul could have jumped in the lifeboat, but he chose to ride out the storm with the Lord. It was a long, fearful struggle with the tempest. The winds blew a strong gale. The waves were wild with fury. The rain poured down in torrents. Those angry elements beat down with ceaseless rage and tore the sails apart. But Paul told the men to cut the ropes and let the lifeboat go. That's trust. If you find it hard to imagine that storm, years ago there was a movie called The Perfect Storm, where three storms came together from the Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, and the East Pacific. The waves were taller than this fishing boat, and it just swallowed up the fishing boat, and the three men drowned in the boat. Had they listened to the fishermen who told them to turn back and go on land until the storm passed, they would have lived. Instead, the other two thought they could go through the storm. Too many Christians panic when things start to fall apart. They take matters into their own hands and end up missing their blessing. They fall trapped to Satan's lie that they know better than God's what's best for them. But Paul knew that to survive, he had to allow God to transform his thinking and renew his mind. As a person thinks, so is he. Proverbs 23:7. If you think God can save you, he will. If you think God can restore you, he will. If you think God can reward you, he will. God rewards us for completely trusting him. Paul's decision to stay on the boat to the end proved to be the right choice, God's choice. Even though the boat fell apart, every man made it to the island not far off. If you keep reading the story, you'll find that even though the island was inhabited by barbarians, the murderous population embraced the ship's passengers and did them no harm. In fact, they were gracious hosts who built a fire to warm their wet bodies. Even when Paul was bitten by a poisonous snake, he was unscathed. It's okay. You can say, "Thank you, Jesus." Let me tell you a story. It's about a British grandmother during World War II. At the height of the London Blitz, she refused to leave her downtown apartment. Every day her son would urge her to move to his suburban home, a safer distance from the bombing. But she stubbornly refused. Her work was to help the wounded and the homeless. She was needed, and besides that, she trusted the words on a plaque over her door. The plaque read, "Don't worry, it may never happen." Her spirit gave her peace to trust those words. Notice the sentence, "It may never happen." One word, look at the word "may," meaning there is a possibility that it could happen. She did not let it stop her or change her thinking, because she was doing God's work, and she believed he would protect her. Her belief and trust in God was solid. She was not afraid. Every time her son begged her to leave, she would point to that plaque and reassure him that all would be well. One day it happened. Her apartment complex was bombed. 2/3 of the building was demolished. Her son rushed to the building when he heard the news. He found her rocking in her favorite chair, singing her favorite hymn. "What about that motto now, Mom?" he shouted. "It didn't see you through." "Oh my gracious, I forgot to turn it over," she said. She got up and flipped the plaque over, and it read, "Don't worry, you can take it." That's the message God has for you in the midst of your storm. Don't worry, you can take it. Just allow the Lord to transform your thinking. Learn to rely on your relationship with him. Submit to his will and trust the outcome to the Lord. If you think your problems can't be solved, trust God. If you think your marriage can't be solved, trust God. If you think your hurts can't be healed, trust God. If you think your doubts can't be dissolved, trust God. If you think bad habits can't be broken, trust God. If you think your failures can't be helped, trust God. When you can't, God will. God will remove all fears and doubts. There is no need to throw in the towel like you are a victim. Trust God. He is always victorious. He will turn your sorrows into joy. He will turn your burdens into blessings. He'll turn your minuses into pluses. He will turn your despair into hope. He will turn your doubt into faith. He will turn your disappointment into fulfillment. Because when you can't, God will. May the Lord bless all who heard my message. When you can't, God will. Let us pray. Lord God, I hope your message transform minds tonight, to trust in you who will not leave nor forsake you. In the midst of this long pandemic, inspire the spirits of those to trust the scientists, realizing, Lord, you predestined these people to study viruses and to guide us accordingly, not of their own volition, but to save your people, your creation, your world. Amen. For the grace of God and the peace of God go with you tonight. Amen.
Oh, let the church,
say amen.
Yeah. Can I get a witness?
Let the church,
oh,
say amen.
To what his plans are.
Let the church,
to what his word
say
says.
Amen.
God has spoken.
God has spoken.
Let the church.